So Cindy has a very interesting and busy background. She graduated with an M.D., M.P.H. From New York University. So and then she went out and did a Ph.D. in basically microbial ecology at Northern Arizona University. And she finished this by doing a residency in pathology at Johns Hopkins. And actually is working there for a startup as well right now to develop new and really frontline diagnostic systems. She won't be talking about this today, but that's another thing she does. Her research is really about translating the microbiome into clinical setting, and I think that both her academic side and her startup side actually mix very well together. And it's very focused on trying to modify the host susceptibility to pathogen, and she's been working on HIV and as well as staphylococcus aureus. So she's going to tell us all about it today. And the title of her talk is Why Absolute Abundance Matters in Translational Microbiome Research. Cindy.
Thank you, Jacques. Hi, everyone. Good morning. And it's really a pleasure to be here. Thank you for the opportunity to talk with you about my work. And so today I want to tell you, talk to you about why I think absolute abundance matters in translational microbiome research. I will make my argument by showing you the results from two of my research projects, which I think both are very exciting. Hope you agree. So to this particular audience, I don't have to explain to you what microbiome is. And I know that for this particular group, that you don't just care about what microbiome research is today. You care about what microbiome research is tomorrow, the future of this field. And I would also say that I believe that you're with me in thinking that what we hope for microbiome research isn't just cheap entertainment, but what we want is something useful. And so that is our hope. And so for me, you know, thinking that microbiome can have a lot of relevance in multiple different fields, but for me as a clinician scientist, I can broadly summarize what I think is the promise of microbiome research into three different areas. So to explain to you what I think the potential promise of translational microbiome research, so the first promise that I think about is the potential of microbiome research to expand the classical infectious disease framework. Now this is already happening. Now we understand that not all microbes are pathogens, that there are some that may be beneficial and almost essential. We also think about the role of microbes in disease, expanding the classical framework of pathogens into the potential role of ecological imbalance, contributing to disease or potentially the loss of good bacteria as another potential mechanism. And importantly, I think that microbiome research can also redefine what we think of as a communicable condition. Again, building on the single pathogen framework, but thinking of potentially the ecological imbalance, dysbiosis itself may be transmissible. I think about the second promise of translational microbiome research in that as we begin to think about the microbiome as this new host factor, we recognize that it can play a role not only in infectious diseases, but also potentially chronic conditions. And as we build our knowledge in the diagnostic, prognostic, and therapeutic utility of the microbiome, we can then develop the necessary diagnostic tools to collect these information in the clinical setting. And then the third promise of translational microbiome research is expanding, you know, our current armament for treating infectious diseases, which relies heavily on broad-spectrum antibiotics, the whole scorched earth effect, and expanding that into different territories that range from prebiotics to working with live organism, pro-ecobiotics, or different types of molecules, narrow-spectrum antibiotics, bacteriocins, or even phage therapy. So where I see we are today, I mean, we're really at this junction where we're faced with this challenge of translating what we're studying in the observational setting observational microbiome research and translating that into the tools that will fulfill the promise. And so to that I say, something that matters a lot is the study metric. And so by that I mean the difference between the relative or proportional abundance and absolute abundance. And I will first define this for you. So relative abundance, this is the most common metric that is used in most microbiome research today. And so this particular metric looks at the microbiome from a perspective of a pie chart. This is my pie. Mm-hmm. So with relative abundance, what you are measuring is the proportion of a specific microbiome that comprises of a bacterium of interest. And so the limitation to relative abundance, I would argue, is that if this is a metric that is agnostic to the size of the pie, such that different sizes of the pie gives you the same relative abundance. However, absolute abundance takes into account the size of the pie, and this can really matter. And as the microbiologists in this audience can attest, we know that bacteria in nature can exist in the order of thousands of cells, up to millions and trillions of cells, and therefore, although the difference I'm showing you here is not large, potentially in nature, this can make a big difference. So this is the difference between relative and absolute abundance. Now, why do I think absolute abundance matters in translational microbiome research? The first thing I think is that absolute abundance is more clinically relevant. So in the clinical microbiology lab, oftentimes density is used really as a way to differentiate between colonization and infection. And this is evident in the use of colony-forming units in making a diagnosis in things ranging from urinary tract infections to wound infections. But also, as we look at microbiome with an eye towards the relevance for antibiotic resistance, absolute abundance can also bridge the gap when we are thinking of population genetics to community ecology. And I would also say that absolute abundance matters because it will facilitate longitudinal studies that we would conduct that looks at the dynamics of microbiome over time, and also relevant for looking at the effect of different interventions that we're interested in. I also argue that absolute abundance is more biologically relevant in that, as we know, bacteria can grow at very different rates, and therefore it is highly possible that absolute abundance is potentially an intrinsic property of the microbiome that we're seeking to study. And on top of that, we already know that there are density-dependent actions that bacteria can have, such as that's mediated by mechanisms such as quorum sensing. And therefore, it's possible that the density of bacteria can be tied to different actions that could lead to potentially competition or cooperation in the community. There are some additional things that I think make absolute abundance really important translational microbiome research, but I'll focus on these two. And now I will try to support my argument with some data from two of my research projects. So these are the two bodies that I study. As Jacques mentioned, I study the nasal microbiome in the context of Staph aureus colonization infection. I study the male genital tract interest in HIV susceptibility, and I'll start there. So this is a map of the rates of HIV infection in the early 2000s, but as you know, this is an ongoing pandemic. And this is a pandemic that disproportionately affects countries in sub-Saharan Africa, as shown here by the red. So what happened was that earlier on, once scientists had the tool to diagnose HIV infection, that they went out and did these prevalence studies in different African countries, what they found was that there were actually widely varying rates of infection. And so earlier on, what they did these epidemiologic investigations. Eventually, they found this very significant association between male circumcision rates and the rates of HIV infection. So So to test this hypothesis, eventually three large randomized control trials were conducted. One in Kenya, one in Uganda, and then one in South Africa. And they show very similar results. Male circumcision reduces the risk of HIV by 60%. This is one of the most effective tools we have for reducing HIV acquisition in men today, still. So, while it's great, we have this very effective tool, it's still very important for us to better understand how male circumcision protects, partly because, it's not an option that's necessarily available to everyone, it's still surgery, and also the fact that although it's 60% effective, could we make it even better? So it's important for us to know how male circumcision reduces HIV acquisition. This is a picture of an uncircumcised penis. The different landmarks that are shown here includes the outer and the inner foreskin, and the glands of the penis, and then also the frenulum. And what is understood is that HIV sexual acquisition in men primarily occurs through exposure of the virus of the sites that are highlighted here in red, the inner foreskin and the frenulum. So therefore, by removing the foreskin, what you're doing is, number one, reducing the surface area, and you're also leaving the area that have a thicker keratin layer, and then also by removing the space that's between the inner foreskin and the glands, that's also removing the space where reducing the moisture in that space that can decrease viral viability. So these are some of the major hypotheses, but what I'm interested in is the potential that male circumcision could also reduce HIV acquisition in part by modifying the penile microbiome with and without circumcision over time. So we have HIV negative adult men that were randomized to a control group, which was delayed circumcision, or to an intervention group, which was immediate circumcision. And so we had samples that were collected at baseline and at year one in both groups that allow us to look at the temporal change in both groups. What we did was that we had swabs that were collected at the coronal sulcus. This is the junction between the glands and the shaft of the penis. It's a landmark that's present irrespective of your circumcision status. So using the coronal sulcus swabs, we extracted total DNA from the eluent, and we did two 16S rRNA gene-based characterization. One is by sequencing, and the other is by this PAM bacterial qPCR that I developed during my PhD. And so what the sequencing gave us was the proportional abundance measures of different bacteria. And what we did was that we took that proportional abundance data and then just multiplied by the total bacterial density, and that allowed us to estimate the absolute abundance of the different penile bacteria. So first, what we did was we looked at the overall composition of the penile microbiome. In the control group, so this is a non-metric multidimensional scaling plot. Each data point here represents the overall microbial composition of a particular penile swab specimen. And so what you can see here is that in the control group, our men, the group didn't have a significant change in the penile microbiome from baseline to year one. And in contrast, in intervention arm group men, you see that there's a significant shift in penile microbiome after circumcision. And what characterizes this overall shift in the penile microbiome? What we found was that this absolute abundance of a diverse set of penile anaerobes decreased significantly after circumcision in the intervention arm men as opposed to the control group. And this is matched with the corresponding minor increase in the absolute abundance of skin-associated bacteria, non-strict anaerobes. We saw a similar decrease in the prevalence, or the presence and absence of penile anaerobes in the intervention group after circumcision as well, up to 40% reduction in some anaerobes prevalence, again with the corresponding increase in the prevalence of skin-associated bacteria after circumcision as compared to the control group. So what this led us to conclude, there was a significant shift, yes, after circumcision, the penile microbiome that's characterized by decrease in the total amount of penile bacteria, that's characterized by decreasing the absolute prevalence of peanut anaerobic bacteria. So as we then move on to test another piece of our hypothesis, what we wanted to look at was the relationship between the absolute abundance of peanut anaerobes to the cytokine chemokine reduction and the absolute abundance of the peanut anaerobes to HIV risk. So first I just want to explain a little bit what the biological mechanism could be for peanut anaerobes and HIV risk. As I mentioned, we think that this could occur through the effects that peanut microbiome can have on recruitment and activation of HIV target cells. So what you need to know, and so this is my cartoon of the peanut epithelium. So what you need to know is that the main HIV target cell that we know of, the CD4 plus T cells, is not typically present in high amounts or in activated states in the peanut epithelium. And so therefore, when there are pro-inflammatory bacteria that's present on the surface of peanut epithelium that can trigger the production of inflammatory factors, chemokines, cytokines, that could then be sent out as essentially a signal that can activate and recruit CD4 plus T cells that are normally residing in the blood or the lymphoid tissues. And therefore, by bringing the activated CD4 plus T cells closer to the peanut epithelium, you're really setting up, you're increasing the risk, therefore when there's exposure to the virus, that the infection can occur at a higher likelihood. So therefore, the study that we conducted tried to look at the link between the absolute abundance of anaerobes with the inflammatory markers and the absolute abundance of the anaerobes with HIV seroconversion risk. And the way we did this was using a case control study, again, that's nested within the original randomized control trial. And so what we had were essentially cases which were men that seroconverted during the 2-year study period. And we also had controls. These are men who are from the same clinical trial who remained HIV negative during the 2-year study period. And so what we did was that from the same swab that were collected from each individual at baseline, we were able to characterize the peanut microbiome based on relative absolute abundance as well. And then also looked at the cytokine profile in each specimen. So first though, when we looked at the characteristics of the participants in this case control study, what we found was that the cases were more likely to have certain risk profiles that are already known to be associated with HIV acquisition, and so basically number of non-marital sexual partners, marital status. So these are the things that we adjusted for in the analyses that I will show you. So first, we looked at the association between anaerobic absolute abundance and HIV risk. And so what we did was that we calculated the risk, incremental increase in risk associated with the tenfold increase in the absolute abundance of different anaerobes that are reduced by circumcision. And so what I'm showing you here, for Prevotella, for example, the light bar, the purple bar, is the arm-adjusted 95% confidence interval in the odds ratio. And the black bar is showing, after adjustment, the association between anaerobic absolute abundance and the risk for HIV seroconversion effect shifted to the right, which means it increased. Of the 10 anaerobes that we had looked at that were reduced by male circumcision, we found that 8 out of the 10 had a link between the absolute abundance and the increased risk for HIV seroconversion. So this is very interesting, and it's shocking when you have a certain hypothesis and it's actually supported by your data. So this is what we have. And now a little bit more on the biological link then. So as I mentioned, we were also able to look at the cytokine that's present in the specimen to the absolute abundance of anaerobes that are present. And so what we found was that there's a significant link between the amount of anaerobes that's present and then the number of cytokines that are detectable. So there's significant increases in the likelihood of having one, two, three, or more cytokines as compared to having no detectable cytokines, with each tenfold increase in the absolute abundance of amylin. And next, we were able to then zoom in to this cytokine. It's known as a cytokine, but it's really more like a chemokine, interleukin 8. So this is the one chemokine that we had in our sample that's present at high enough concentration for us to look at this quantitatively. And so, as it turned out though, IL-8 is actually a very interesting marker, because what it's known for is that essentially it can trigger a pathway that involves macrophages that lead to actually the recruitment of a subset of CD4 plus T cells that are known to be highly susceptible to HIV, the Th17 CD4 plus T cells. So this is the signal that gets sent out that triggers the recruitment of Th17 CD4 plus T cells to the foreskin. So what we found, and again, we did this for all the anaerobes, but I'll show you what we did. So here, what we found on the x-axis is the absolute abundance of the anaerobe. The y-axis is the concentration of IL-8 that we measured. And so this is showing that there seems to be a threshold effect where if you have a certain range, a lower range of absolute abundance of the anaerobe, there isn't a significant increase in the amount of ILA. However, when you pass a certain threshold, all of a sudden there's a very marked increase in the relationship, a steep slope, steeper slope. And so when we looked at the relationship between the absolute abundance of each of the anaerobe with the ILA concentration, what we found was that 8 out of 10 anaerobes that we examined, there was a significant relationship between anaerobe abundance, ILA concentration. And so the data that we have so far is encouraging in terms of supporting the hypothesis that we started off with. And the next step that I'm showing here is that we are now in the process of correlating the anaerobe absolute abundance to actual cells in the foreskin that were collected and analyzed by flow cytometry. But I would just summarize what I have to show you by saying that what we found is that a particular ecological imbalance, basically the increased absolute abundance of different anaerobes, could affect the risk of HIV acquisition in men. And in men, this particular dysbiosis is resolved with the procedure of medical male circumcision. And as Jacques and many of you here, and Rebecca, you guys know in this room, I think a similar anaerobic dysbiosis occurs in women with bacterial vaginosis. And I have another study that I've done that I'm not talking about today, was that demonstrating that these anaerobic bacteria could actually be shared by sexual partners, and therefore this supports the fact that this dysbiosis may likely be sexually transmissible. And so I love thinking about this because it breaks so many rules, and I think that our findings so far suggest ability to HIV. And so what we conclude is that, well, if there are certain bacteria that can increase an individual's risk, we think likely sometime in the future this could be, we can come up with solutions that can modify this risk factor. So now I would just shift gears and go on and talk to you about my work on a different body site. And so the next story will have to do with the nasal microbiome. And specifically, this is a story about nasal microbiome host genetics and the susceptibility to Staph aureus colonization. So I think most of you here in the audience knows that Staph aureus is one of the most important opportunistic human pathogens, period, that we face today. And I would say that probably the most important risk factor for developing Staph aureus infection is to be colonized by Staph aureus. And while Staph aureus can colonize different body sites, the nasal cavity is really the one that's been studied and is thought to be one of the most important. And so therefore, it's really important for us to better understand the determinants of Staph aureus nasal colonization. Why do people get colonized? Why are some people not? It's important for us to understand the determinants of nasal Staph aureus colonization, and this can allow us to develop new strategies for preventing colonization, reducing infection. So what are the key determinants of colonization? Well, we know that Staph aureus is not Staph aureus, is not Staph aureus, that there are differences on the strain level. And so virulence factors can play an important role. And also, we know that specific clones or sequence types of Staph aureus are better at colonizing and infecting than others. So that's important. We also know that occupational environmental exposure can play a role. Healthcare workers, veterinarians, they're higher risk for becoming colonized. And we also know that actually being a man increases your risk for becoming colonized and also infected by Staph aureus. So what we do know, too, is that actually the host, the genetics of the host, doesn't have a significant effect on whether somebody is colonized by Staph aureus or not. And this is demonstrated by a twin study that was conducted in Denmark. The Danish twin registry. So now, when this came out, it was interesting to think about, but then what this sort of makes the interpretation of another study difficult in that. So what researchers did was that they basically colonized this collection of Staph aureus that are known to be They cultured a collection of Staph aureus that are known to be good colonizers, and then they enrolled individuals that are not yet colonized with Staph aureus. I don't know how they were able to convince people to join the study, but anyway, so they enrolled a bunch of people who were non-carriers of Staph aureus, and what they did is that they took actually the cultures of Staph aureus and they challenged these individuals directly with nasal lavages of Staph aureus. And what they found was that individuals that are not colonized with Staph aureus, they're not able to establish colonization in these individuals. And so this would suggest that there is some host-specific factors in determining whether somebody is colonized by Staph aureus or not. But how do we understand that in the context of the lack of association between host genetics and Staph aureus? Well, as we start to think about the nasal microbiome as an additional host factor, potentially we think about perhaps the host genotype or phenotype can play a role in commensal bacteria that's present, and that can then determine Staph aureus nasal colonization. Or perhaps the unique microbiome that you have, your nasal microbiome itself, can directly determine Staph aureus nasal colonization. So to answer this question, we work with the individuals that published the large study on Staph aureus colonization host genetics, the Danish Twin Registry. And what we did was that we had samples from three different types of twins, monozygotic twins, same sex, and then opposite sex twins. The particular cohort that we had, there were more women in the study than men. And also the fact that these individuals, they are a little bit older, so they're middle-aged to older. So what we had were nasal swabs from these study participants, and we did two things. So first, we cultured these for Staph aureus, and second, we characterized the nasal microbiome based on proportional and also acid abundance. So what we saw, so just the first thing that we saw was that there were really distinct community state types that are present in the individuals that are in the study. Oops. Oops. many of the nasal community's day types, except one, are dominated by a specific organism. So for example, CST1 is dominated by Staph aureus, CST2 is dominated by Enterobacteriaceae, CST3 dominated by Staph epidermidis. We have a particular CST that's without a noticeable dominant organism, and then the others are dominated by Moraxella, Corynebacterium, and the Dolosie grainworm. So now we're drilling in a little further in the interaction between host genetics and the commensal bacteria and Staph aureus. So one of the first things that we found was that the absolute abundance of Staph aureus that's present in the nasal microbiome is actually relevant to Staph epidemiology, and I'll show you why. So what we found when we sequenced the nasal microbiome of these twins is that we found that we have a higher number of individuals that are positive for Staph aureus by sequencing than by culture. Now about 50% by sequencing and 30% by culture. So what we wanted to do was to look at how these two were correlated. And what we found was that Staph aureus absolute abundance had a perfect relationship with culture-based outcomes, and therefore, and specifically individuals that have low absolute abundance of Staph aureus, they have very low likelihood of being positive by culture. And in fact, there's this perfect linear relationship with each tenfold increase in Staph aureus absolute abundance, you're 33% more likely to have a positive nasal culture. So this is really interesting to us. And so the next thing that we did was to look at Staph aureus nasal colonization. And because this is a well-known fact that men are more likely to be colonized and infected by Staph aureus, so when we first looked at our data, we found actually by sequencing, we were equally likely to detect Staph aureus in men as women. It's like, again, 50% in both. So this really made my collaborators very unhappy, because how could it be that we're sequencing out this result and it's not matching with what's expected based on epidemiology, culture-based studies? So then what we did was that we looked at, this could potentially be explained by difference in Staph aureus absolute abundance. So what we found, and this is what we expected, is that women are more likely to be colonized by low absolute abundance of Staph aureus than men. And therefore, this explains why. So this, the difference in colonization of Staph aureus absolute abundance could explain the difference in the risk seen epidemiologically between men and women. And the next, what we looked at, two told us that the nasal total bacterial density or absolute abundance is an important host trait. So when we tried to look at the relationship between host genetics and nasal microbiome composition, what we found was that host genetics really didn't play a significant role in what types of bacteria is present. But there was a significant correlation between the amount of bacteria that's present based on host genetics. Now, this could be because monozygotic twins have like the same shape nose, right? But still, we see this stepwise relationship that suggests to us that there could be something else going on, that host genetics could directly play a role in determining the amount of bacteria that's present in the nose. And also what we found was that when you look at total nasal bacterial density, men were colonized by more bacteria than women. And the next thing that we looked at, too, that told us that absolute abundance can also play an important role in the relationship between commensal bacteria and Staph aureus. And specifically, what we tried to look at was the relationship of the absolute abundance of different commensal bacteria and the presence and absence of Staph aureus. And what we did was that we took a decision tree based approach where it allowed us to basically extract the most informative, meaningful attribute and its relationship with a particular outcome of interest. So it's basically extracting out the most informative attribute, being A, followed by B, C, so forth, and it's significantly associated with an outcome of interest. And so with the decision tree analysis, what we found was that there seemed to be, again, this threshold-based effect in determining whether somebody is or is not colonized by staph aureus. As I mentioned before, the rate of staph aureus colonization or the presence of staph aureus by sequencing is about 50%. So these individuals, so this particular group have a threshold, 10 to the 6, are significantly less likely to be colonized by staph aureus. And so this is the decision tree analysis that we completed. And this was the initial tree, which we validated with additional resample validation sets. So here are the major finding from the nasal microbiome study that we did, in that what we found first was that staph aureus absorbance is an important factor that helps to bridge the findings we have from sequencing microbiome research to culture-based studies, classical epidemiology. What we found too was that absorbance is a significant factor that's related to the host, both in terms of host genetics and also what the individual sex. Absorbance also help us to solve this big dilemma that we have in trying to resolve why we're seeing different things by sequencing and by culture. And last but not least, our work done with absorbance also now allow us to better understand the potential ecological interaction between commensal bacteria and staph aureus in understanding that there could be potentially antagonism that's associated with abundance of commensal. But I want to finish this up actually by putting this together because, again, this is something that I just really enjoy thinking about, I want to share with you. So, you know, I would say that before I did this study, you know, to me the world was really black and white, that there is individuals who have staph aureus or who not. But potentially there can actually be a carriage state that is culture negative. And so whereas the world by culture, you might only see the individuals that are shown here in red, the culture positive carriage, there may be many more individuals that are out there who are not yet detected. And so therefore, the implication of this for surveillance and transmission is that you could potentially have individuals that you wouldn't pick up in the hospital or in the clinic by culture who are in this, you know, my hypothesized culture negative carriage state. And that when these individuals, when they are exposed or interact with the individuals who are capable of carrying high absorbance of staph aureus, these individuals can become colonized and they are at increased risk for infection. And there can be subsequently even more transmissions that occur that are not detected because these individuals don't carry staph aureus at high absorbances. But later down the road, someone who can carry high absorbance of staph aureus can then be affected. And also thinking about the sex difference in staph aureus absorbance, you know, this can potentially have relevance in transmissions, for example, with younger children. So this has important, I think, potentially important relevance for surveillance and transmission of staph aureus. So these are all the results that I have to show you today. But really, I want to bring it back to just wrap this up by saying, you know, I showed you all these results to make my argument that I think, and I hope maybe convince you a little bit today, that absorbance matters in translational microbiome research. And that I hope that I convince you to some degree that it matters because it's clinically relevant and it's biologically relevant. And I also hope that you can see more that with absolute abundance in translational microbiome research, we can hopefully better fulfill the promises of the microbiome research that we're doing today. And so I would say that, like, my last hope for, you know, the journey or the quest that we're all, many of us are embarking on in making translational microbiome research meaningful and impactful, is that actually we are not just doing things or making things that are useful, but actually hopefully we'll find something that is exciting and wholly unexpected. So that's my hope. And this work was done with a lot of different individuals from many different institutions, George Washington University, where I'm at currently, but also collaborators at Johns Hopkins, here at University of Maryland, at University of Toronto, that's the immunologist team on the PNOW microbiome research, and then of course the Kai Health Sciences program, and as well as individuals at the Translational Genomics Research Institute, where I used to work. This is in Arizona. And individuals at Northern Arizona University and the Stanford Institute, and then, of course, the study participants. This is funding. So now there's time for questions.